You're in for a tweet, and a treat. Dr. Jay Sutay joins us. He's the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. He's in for a treat. He's going to go see Colin Quinn for the first time. You've never seen Colin perform live?
Well, I've seen everything he's done on TV and all of his one-man shows, but I've never seen him live. So the girlfriend texted me today. She said, what do you think about going to see Colin Quinn Saturday? I said, absolutely. So that's on the books.
She's a keeper. If she likes Colin Quinn, you want to hold on to her.
And she bought the tickets, too.
Ooh. Wow.
Yeah.
Are you having a good summer?
I am. I'm having a terrific summer. Going to San Francisco in a couple of weeks to, for whatever reason, see the Mets play the Giants. But that's on the books, too. Gotta live life, buddy.
The way New York City subways are, you probably have a better chance seeing the Mets in San Francisco than trying to get to Shea.
Shea. It's not Shea anymore.
City?
I'll always call it Shea. City Field.
Yeah.
But it's always Shea Stadium to me, even if Shea Stadium is a parking lot now.
They didn't need to build another stadium.
You know, people want their amenities. They want their suites. They want comfortable chairs. It's, you know, and then they just stare at their own phones in their hands anyhow and get hit in the skull by foul balls. We never needed. We didn't need netting to protect the crowd for the 150 years baseball existed before these idiots can't keep their eye on the field and have to be looking at their phones all the time. Uh-huh. They deserve to be struck in the head.
It was scary to go to a baseball game. I'm being serious.
You had to be on alert. You had to be on alert.
I would bring my mitt.
Me too.
And pretend I wanted a foul ball. I didn't want it coming anywhere near me.
Well, not a line drive foul ball, but a pop-up, you know, can of corn, right?
Yeah. There was a time when the best seats at a stadium were along the third baseline, or the first baseline, Right. And then they decided it's too dangerous, so they built fancier stadiums with box seats and priced the real fans out.
Right, that's right. Yeah, now you got to look through screens. I feel like I'm watching a High Life Ronton game.
There's no benefit to the city building a stadium. They give tax cuts to football teams to build stadiums that are used, what, 10 times a year? How many times is a football stadium used?
Home games, I think 8 home games a year.
How many jobs does that create?
On a Sunday, one day a week.
And they give all these tax breaks to these football teams to keep them in the city, claiming they're going to be jobs. There are no jobs. Jobs that they do create don't pay a lot.
Although I will say that Dunkin' Donuts Park down in Hartford with our AA Yard Goats is a very nice stadium to watch a game in. Very comfortable.
I agree.
I'm not complaining about that. They got high tops with swivel bar stools in the outfield. You could just sit there and have a couple of cocktails on a nice night and enjoy a ball game.
I would do that. My daughter took me to see the AAA team out by Coney Island.
Cyclones?
The Cyclones. Fantastic. So much fun. So much more entertaining. I think tickets along the third baseline were $10. I got hit in the ball by a line drive. I felt young again.
That's right. I remember one of the coaches I had in Little League, man. You saw this ball coming from the outfield. He wasn't even looking. Nailed him right in the nuts. I never saw a grown man drop so hard. And I don't think I ever laughed so hard in my life either, because it was like the funniest thing I'd seen up to the age of 13.
What's the count? No balls.
He got two balls, both of them.
Should children be allowed to play Little League?
I think so. Sure.
Yeah.
I think it's a, you know, pretty much a non-contact sport, but baseball is something that is so unique to this country. Well, you know, and the Dominican Republic, of course. But do you ever wonder why the Dominican Republic produces so many baseball players, and yet it's on an island that's split in half? Haiti's on the other side. I've never seen a Haitian ball player. Where they got no driftwood or balls on half of the island. It's strange, but there's some animal husbandry going on down in the Dominican Republic. I'll tell you that much. Breeding baseball players down there, buddy.
They're breeding baseball players down
there. Yes, they are.
Football. Would you let your kid play football?
I wouldn't. No. knowing what I know now, fortunately I had daughters, so I didn't have to make that decision. But right now, I don't know. I probably have a very awkward, uncoordinated kid like his father. So the chances of him getting his bell rung a number of times are pretty, pretty good. So I would say no to football.
Don't all professional football players have that? Is it CTE? What is the
protein? Yeah, CTE.
They all have it. They've done autopsies. Every
kids
brain.
Kids have it. Kids who play soccer and head the ball. I mean, the only way you can diagnose it now is with autopsy. But there is a protein, as you mentioned, that is elevated in people with the brain trauma, even on a small level. So that might help us to see how far back this stuff actually goes. I mean, kids fall and smack their head all the time anyhow, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's that chronic, you know, even if you're not hitting the head, it's the jarring of your head back and forth that can cause problems too. It doesn't have to be a direct impact to the head in a concussion. It could be, you know, just significant blows.
I don't mean to throw you a curveball, but we're talking baseball. On the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, we had a guest who is not a doctor, but she's done a documentary on Alzheimer's disease.
Yep.
All, you know, to be fair to Dr. Sutay, you're a pediatrician. I hope you don't see too many cases of Alzheimer's disease.
No dementia on my watch.
But she says that Alzheimer's is overrated, that there's almost a myth to Alzheimer's disease, that our brains are actually healthier now than they were 50 years ago, that if you do CAT scans of older people, their brains are much healthier than they've ever been, that there isn't an epidemic of Alzheimer's. Have you heard this?
I haven't, but I have to imagine that with people living longer, I mean, dementia may be the, you know, one of the end results of aging. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. we don't have a lot of years under our belts with people living into their, 90s and 100 years old. And but for young onset Alzheimer's, you have to wonder if those people don't have some kind of predisposition to an earlier onset of an aging brain. But
she said that there's the gene, an Alzheimer's gene, but it only manifests itself at 60 or before. But if you make it past 60, the gene doesn't kick in, and they're not so sure it's Alzheimer's.
Oh, six years to go, thank God.
And that exercise is probably more effective than any drug that is being advertised on television for Alzheimer's. That if you exercise, it's the best way to maintain your memory.
Yep, that's true. Good diet, lots of physical activity and exercise.
The epidemic of Alzheimer's is overstated. I've also heard that, and I hate to say this because I loathe the NRA, and this is an inconvenient truth for us liberals, but the number of people dying from guns has actually gone down.
Total number, but number of people at one time is probably still up there pretty good, right?
Well, actually, per year, and even the number of mass shootings has gone down. But it's still an epidemic. You still have close to, 50,000 people dying each year from guns. But it's not trending upwards. And not that suicide is a trivial thing, but a lot of those people dying from guns are self-inflicted.
Right.
Which is also a serious problem. Why are so many Americans committing suicide?
Well, that's a big problem. It's lack of hope.
Yeah. And so families are frightened that their children are going to find their guns and use them.
Yeah, if they're not stored safely in the house.
There's a new advertising campaign telling parents to do what?
Basically, to keep their guns stored safely. It's a really interesting ad that they have. It's a father talking to his son about, and the kid, kids are going to find a gun if it's in the house and unsecured.
Yeah.
And, you know, and the father says, you know, I want to have access to it in case I need to protect you guys quickly. And the kid says, well, I know it's under your sweatshirt on the, you know, the top shelf of the closet, you know, that kind of thing. And it really is scary because, you know, there's a lot of kids, 4.6 million kids that live in homes where there's at least one gun, and 8 kids die a day in this country from an accidentally discharged firearm that isn't stored safely. So that's a pretty scary thing. But the ad council, the people that brought us Smokey the Bear, have a good commercial out there. So if you want to find it, it's on YouTube, End Family Fire. It's pretty interesting, though. But I do think, I mean, this is something I talk about every day. I mean, people get annoyed when I ask them if they have any firearms in the house and where are they stored and where's the ammunition. But it is part of my job. I make sure the kids ride in seatbelts and car seats and wear bike helmets and put on sunscreen and check for ticks and all this other stuff. And, you know, it's like, I don't care that you have guns in your house. I just want to know if you have them, that they're not in a place where the kids can get them and they're locked up, stored separate from the ammunition, and make sure that they know that. And I have handouts to give and such, but people are offended that I would even ask, but I ask, you know, I ask about everything that has to do with safety.
In Florida, they passed the Firearm Owners Privacy Act.
Right. Doctors can't ask that question in Florida. You're absolutely right.
And it's probably as important as asking, did you get a vaccine?
Right. Or, you know, do you wear your seatbelt? All of those safety related things is, you know, with the little kids, you know, is the house safety proofed? Outlets are covered and no dangling cords that the kid can hang himself on. And, you know, there's different stages of different safety things I have to discuss when the kids come in for a checkup. But with the older kids, I mean, you want to make sure if there are guns in the house, they can't get to them.
Shouldn't you ask adults if they keep guns in their house? And are you depressed? And how are you feeling?
It might be. I mean, if a psychiatrist makes a diagnosis of depression on a patient and starts them on medication, and just by starting them on medication, it can increase the risk of suicide in some people. That would be a very important question. And I don't know if the American Psychiatric Association does that or not. It's a good question. I don't know.
Gun ownership is considered a civil right in this country. Not getting shot is not a civil right in this country.
Right.
It would be nice. Yeah, I would like to know the number of Americans who have stopped a crime or have stopped a shooting with their gun. I have a friend who sends me an article every time somebody supposedly saves their life with a gun. I get these maybe once a month, and if you read the article carefully, they're not really sure if the gun saved that person from being killed. Guns right. don't really keep you safe. They're a security blanket. It's like a teddy bear that you sleep with at night that makes you feel safe. But if somebody breaks into your home and you whip out your gun,
chances are they're going to use it on you.
They're going to use it on you, or you're going to accidentally kill your dog or somebody you're living with. There are very few examples of people saving their lives with a gun. Very few. Like a handful of incidents each year where somebody got themselves out of trouble with their
gun. Because they got the drop on someone.
Yeah.
You're right. I mean, and again, when you can have trigger locks that are related to your fingerprint, well, if daddy needs to have his gun and daddy needs to protect the family, well, then why don't we have guns that only daddy can fire?
Yeah.
You know? So we have the technology to be able to do that. It's just it makes too much goddamn sense. Mm-hmm. If the kid finds the gun, he can't fire it because he doesn't have the fingerprint or whatever you got to have to be with it. But I just think that we're concentrating and passing laws and worrying about stuff that has little consequence in the big picture. I mean, yeah, we should get the kids out of cages and all that. I get that. But this has been a problem that's just gone on for too long. And what, because it's summer and we haven't had a school shooting in a couple of months, everybody's getting complacent again.
What the two parties argue about is dictated by the consultants who want to rev up the electorate so that they vote, but right. don't really care about what's really important. What's being argued each night on cable news has no bearing on our lives. It's just sizzle. There's no substance.
I learn nothing by watching the news. I will read the news on my phone or on my computer, but I'll tell you, I don't get anything from watch. I have the Yankee game on most of the time. So I have no interest in watching the news on TV because it's not the news anymore. It's an opinion.
They're arguing about stuff that is of no consequence. Like you just said, the rounding up of children and separating them from their parents, that's an issue, but that's a byproduct of a non-issue. That was Trump using a non-issue to distract and divert, and now we have
That's right.
a problem. There's no immigration problem in this country.
Right.
We need that to distract. There's a problem with paying workers a livable wage. There's a problem with corporations shipping jobs overseas. There's probably a problem of slaughterhouses using undocumented workers because undocumented workers don't unionize. They don't complain. They don't demand time and a half when they're overworked. That's an issue, but that's not discussed.
Nope.
It's just the sizzle. And
yeah, it's the only thing that's going to grab the headlines. And people are so dumb that they lump everything together. I mean, people can't distinguish between what's going on with Russia. First of all, the Russia thing, every one of those Trumps, when they filled out their form to be vetted to get their clearance for the White House, they all lied about Russia. Mm-hmm. I go back to that as the first sin. OK, now we know they lied and they lied on a form that's supposed to give them security clearance to protect the White House and protect our country. And they lied on that. And now it's like that was the first sin. Go back to that. They're fucked.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. And everything that comes out of the mouth is untrustworthy. And you used to know you were kind of – sometimes the presidents are talking out of the side of their mouth and you knew we weren't getting the whole truth. But now we're not getting any truth.
It's all one big show for
– It is. It's a TV show.
It's a TV show. But there are people who are like this show.
A TV show to get people to work so the rich – to vote so people can get richer.
That's right. And the people getting rich are the richest 1%. And the consultants, the multi-billion-dollar consultant industry, those are the people who take out the ads and dictate what the candidates will talk about. You know, Overton's window, it's a term devised by this professor Overton. What is reasonable to talk about in political discourse? It's called the Overton window. And mm-hmm. the Overton window is manufactured by the richest 1% and the political consultants who say, this is fair, you can bring this up, but don't talk about this. You can talk about socialism being a bad thing, but you can't talk about the concentration of wealth, the banks owning everything. Okay, I'm rambling. I apologize.
I get it. I get – and you know, it's just – I don't know. I just, for someone that's so open and honest, our president, he's speaking directly to the people. How come he's still running his company? And, you know, it's a disgusting farce, the whole thing. But I get up and go to work every morning because I have children to take care of. So that's all I can do. You know, learned helplessness.
Learned helplessness. And we'll end on this story about heart checkups for young athletes, because one of the things Americans need to learn is what a pediatrician has to deal with every day. And that is, there are no easy answers. Sometimes you can't do anything, but you got to fight the good fight. And that's what Dr. Jay Sutay does every day. And then he does some comedy. So there is an
epidemic. God's work.
God's work.
Yeah.
Doing comedy.
Yeah, of course. That's why you're doing it too. We're servants of the Lord.
Yeah. You do that pediatrician thing just so you can...
That's so I can pay my alimony. That's all I got.
So there is a problem with young athletes who have sudden heart attacks, widowmakers?
The problem is that it happens, and there isn't a good way to predict which kids it's going to happen to, because kids can have a thorough cardiac exam before they play their first sport, but they're finding now that those exams are very difficult to predict who's going to be the person that's going to drop dead. I mean, when it's an obvious thing, it's an obvious thing, but they get, you have plenty of cases of kids who are 100% normal, healthy kids who've been evaluated, had a pre-sports cardiac exam, and they still drop dead at some point because of some kind of cardiac problem. So the point is, yeah, we should screen these kids before they play sports, but it's not really a guarantee that something isn't going to happen.
Now, are you testing cholesterol on kids?
Yeah. Kids who have high BMIs earlier, but routinely we test cholesterols on at the age of 12 and senior year of high school, so 17, 18.
That's incredible. That's a new phenomenon of kids.
Yeah. And not only that, hypertension in kids, they've lowered the numbers for high blood pressure for kids. And, you know, if you look at the numbers, they're going to say the number of kids with hypertension has gone up, but it's only because they lowered the criteria to call it hypertension. So right.
What causes hypertension in a kid?
Lots of things, kidney abnormalities, renal artery stenosis, in little kids. I mean, kids that are born.
So we're not talking about.
They can have polycystic kidneys. They can have kidney failure in little kids. But as kids become, you know, pre-adolescence and adolescence, I certainly have plenty of kids who are, you know, porkers. And that's the reason their cholesterol is up. So.
But you can't have a kid saying, please, I've got hypertension. Don't aggravate me. It's not psychological. It's not surrounding circumstances. It's not parents saying, do your homework.
No. It's usually lack of diet and exercise and congenital things that are just things that kids are born with.
Yeah. Dr. Jay Sutay is the hardest working pediatrician in comedy. Where are you performing next? Or are you taking the summer off? I know our date got pushed back to December 7th, right?
Yeah, I thought it was going to be in October, but now it's December 7th. So I'm going to be opening for the very funny Mr. Mark Normand at the Hartford Funny Bone the 24th through the 26th of this month. And then I'll be at City Steam in September.
That's fantastic. Stay on the line for 1 second, sir.
Sure. Have a good one.
Thank you. Stay on the line.